Thank you very much. Sorry about those technical difficulties. But again, I am representing the National Institutes of Health as well as the National Institute on Aging, and happy to share some perspectives about what we need to be doing going forward. Very specifically, taken by this quote from Justice Brandeis at the beginning of last century, that sunshine is the best disinfectant, and to the degree that we are limited in our enrollment of older adults heretofore, NIH is intent upon allowing more sunshine into the problem and hopefully, along with policies, rectify things. As I've mentioned, we do have, and we're looking forward to, the anonymized individual level data that will be coming from the new IAL policy. The policy is requiring that there be individual level anonymized data of age, at enrollment, sex, gender, race, and ethnicity. And this will allow us to look at a much more granular level of what's happening in enrollment in various studies. This is personally identifiable information potentially, and thus will not necessarily present it in its whole to the outside world, but more in an aggregate, but it'll allow us to aggregate in lots of different ways depending upon the illness of or disease of interest. Additionally, as a result of the 21st Century Cures Act, we have a mandate to share already demographic data from our RCDC system, our system for coding and categorization of diseases and conditions. And there's a new page called the RCDC Inclusion Statistic Report that already shows data from our triennial report last year. So it's fiscal year 18 data, and it goes by every single one of the categories in RCDC providing demographics. For instance, in the age category, you see here data with regards to sex, gender, race, ethnicity. We are a bit behind in terms of percentages of women involved in clinical studies. This is across NIH. We have a predominance of non-Hispanic whites in our studies, some Blacks, some Native Americans, Asians, and predominantly non-Hispanic and non-Latinos in our studies. The next report is due for fiscal year 21. We're hopeful that we will have age data to report with that as well. And then another thing that came from the 21st Century Cures Act is a mandate for reporting in clinicaltrials.gov. And part of that reporting is on the subjects who've been involved in NIH-defined phase three clinical trials, a requirement that there be reporting of analysis by sex, gender, race, and ethnicity. This is an enhancement of what's been called the valid analysis policy that's been around for quite a while. The expectation that there will be these sorts of analyses to see whether there are differences in groups, regardless of whether there is a statistically significant difference that is found. The thing that's new about this is the requirement that it be reported into clinicaltrials.gov, and that, along with other clinicaltrials.gov requirements, can potentially have an impact on institutions, because if they have scientists who are not consistently reporting, there's the potential for NIH to withhold funds for future clinical studies. I should elaborate that an NIH-defined phase three trial is not only looking at drugs and devices, but behavioral interventions as well. Still another change that's going to put more light on things from the NIH perspective is the reporting out of the outcomes of research performance progress reports. In January of 2017, it was determined that the final RPPR for any grant that's terminated or any award that's not extended should be available, and that was further enhanced in October 2017, that it would be available through NIH reports. And this will also include studies that are funded through a competitive revision. Their final interim report in the first phase would be considered their final report. So there'll be an opportunity for the public to see the outcomes of our clinical studies in a way that was not feasible previously. And then finally, we're really looking forward to the outcomes of a diversity collaborative that has been initiated by the Clinical Trials Transformation Initiative. As many of you know, this is an initiative that was started by Duke University and the FDA, and it's now some 80-member organization. They've recently decided that they wanted to focus on issues with regards to diversity to develop resources to demonstrate the value of increasing diversity in clinical trials and adopting practices that include diverse populations in the development of the process for drugs and devices. Very specifically, their objectives will be to recommend organizational level practice changes, disseminate evidence needed for decision makers to commit sufficient resources for diversity, and identify factors that yield clinical, scientific, and financial return on investment. The National Institutes of Health Inclusion Policy Officer, we have a person who's dedicated to these sorts of issues, is co-chairing this diversity collaborative, and we're really looking forward to outcomes from that to help move the science forward. And then finally, I will again remind you about the Inclusion Across Lifespan 2 workshop that's coming up. It's going to not only be looking at the inclusion of older adults, but children and across the lifespan. Many of the things that have been discussed at this meeting will be further amplified in terms, again, of evidence-based data for being very inclusive and allowing clinical studies to be more generalizable. So looking forward to our panel discussion.